Hi students, I am Dr. Naveen Kumar Jha, Associate Professor in English, RAGS College, Ahilya Sthan. Yesterday we took into account the poem Daffodils, written by a great romantic poet William Wordsworth. We did talk about so many relevant points about the poems, especially the summary part of it was greatly dealt with. Today we have some more important points to consider, and I am going to look at assimilation and poetic device to light on. First, we should consider the process of assimilation of the poem. We know, on the one hand, poet has some say, and he has said through his poems about his experience of nature, about his feeling about nature. On the other hand, we are reader, and we too have our some concerns regarding the viewpoint that poet has raised in this poem. We too can consider nature from our own point of view, and then we can make compare and contrast between the points observed by the poet in this poem and the points we are observing about the natural beauty. This is what is the first point of our elaboration that I am going to make for you. We know that William Wordsworth belongs to Romantic school of English poetry. He is a well-known Romantic and nature poet. He is recognized not only as Romantic poet of English literature, but as a great Romantic philosopher also in the world. In this particular poem, we know that he has some personal experience about natural beauty. Generally, we find that Romantic poet is talking about nature from his own personal experience point of view. And we also notice that he has his own way of consideration of the idea. In this poem too, the poet has been personal in his observation of life that he has spent on the mountain while watching the dance of thousands of daffodils. And we can also say that it is all the natural beauty that the poet is to just give vent to in this poem. And after having a look at that natural beauty, he becomes full with enjoyment at the sight of beautiful daffodils while wandering in the countryside. We have almost the same experience, especially I have almost the same experience. I too love going countryside to watch nature and natural beauty. I can also just spend as much time in the nature as I can, because here it is the really heaven which has been realized on the earth. If really there is any heaven which is a symbolic one for enjoyment and joy, that is the world of nature. So I assimilate my idea with the idea of the poet. That poet also wanders in search of natural beauty that can make him enjoy the life. Similarly, I also wander, find natural world full with beauty and delight. So And even each and every person should be of the same nature, of the same opinion, that he should spend much time of life in search for natural beauty. The moment we are just aloof from nature, we are actually making our life devoid of natural pleasure and natural beauty, and so it has been very badly affecting our health and mental health especially. Amid prosperity, we are just suffering from lots of mental and emotional vacuums. We can say that we are not happy. We do not feel happy despite the fact we are rich, we are affluent, so far as our position of natural beauty is concerned. So we cannot say that it is the right thing that you are doing. We are actually not getting the thing in the right way. So here we have so many things to understand, we have so many things to view, and we can see that it is all the just dancing of daffodils with the bridge that in person the poet is enjoying. He thinks that there is bliss of physical observance of natural beauty. Just one can get blessed with this kind of natural beauty. It is rarely available. It is available only when we are inclined to find and search that kind of thing. Otherwise you will live alone inside. Outside, maybe we are surrounded by lots of possessions, especially physical possessions that we have earned by our toil. But they do not just provide pleasure for just a long period of time. Yes, suppose we have purchased what we can call AC that can just relieve us from heat for the time being. It is from the physical problem that you are facing. We cannot say that it is of no significance. All the physical equipments that we have invented are meant for serving us in some way or the others. They are all just our necessity to exist physically. If we want to live physically, just go on, we need to have all these kind of things. And it is in this way, it is equally important to purchase our own that kind of physical equipments. But it has physical purpose. Yes, and we cannot ignore just a physical necessity. It is not correct to say that there is no value of physical necessity, or we cannot say that just AC and TV and other physical equipments are of no significance for us. Yes, they are also soothing our physical problems. And so when time is off, suppose in summer we need all these kind of things, but when summer is gone, we do not need all these kind of things for just any purpose. So it has a temporary satisfaction to make to us. On the other hand, when we are talking about, you know, the physical just natural world, say just flowers like daffodils, say just the watching of just sea, the watching of river, and watching of orchard, we find that it is the pleasure forever. In all season we can watch it, in all time we can watch it, in all mood we can watch it, and we cannot say that it has any temporary significance. It can make us happy no matter in what season we are there in the nature, no matter in what condition we are there in the nature, no matter in what mood we are in the nature. So it is irrespective of all these conditions, we find certain kind of pleasure there. And similar is the observation of William Wordsworth. He says that the world of nature is not going to betray us. It is not going to deceive us. You know, it only gives and gives. It gives what is termed as pleasure. That is just emotional pleasure, mental pleasure. But on the other hand, whatever physical inventions we have made, they are really providing us comforts, but at the same time, they are just creating lots of problems for us also. Now, just electricity is the best invention that we have made, but it can create lots of environmental pollution as well. It can create lots of, you know, what you can call erroneous situations when we are electrocuted for some reason or others, and it can also make us die. But nature, if we are just going in the nature, is always welcoming us. It is not going to say that for the comfort we have to pay in cost. For the comfort, we are going to just toil hard. No, it is just the presence only among the nature that is much more important. It is not any money that we need to spend. It is not any kind of mental engagement that we want to maintain. We just are relaxed when you are in natural world. So we can say that it is very, very important for us that we are very much blessed with the fragrance, with the flowers. Here, the flowers are daffodils, and especially just dancing of flowers in such a good, beautiful surrounding is just enough for the poet to be enchanted, and it is all for just enjoyment that poet is just finding himself blessed. And we can say there are similar significance of any other natural world that we are trapped there by its beauty. Now here just E.M. Foster is talking about India from that natural beauty point of view. You know, there are some lands which are replete with natural beauty, and our country India is also replete with natural beauty, and we can enjoy it. You know, we can find all the seasons very much available here, and we can find everything that we can find in any part of the world. Here in India we just can enjoy it, but just following the model of Western just material philosophy, we have forgotten everything that our ancestors were always talking about, the fragrance of nature in the Upanishads, in the Vedas, and through different texts, they have tried to make us the part of nature, that our life would be full with beauty and so on. Now, it is what our assimilation is. Now, we can talk that the poet has composed it. Into 6-line stanza, we find that there are 6-line stanza here. It is the first poetic device that which is considered. And we can say that these 6-line stanzas just are written into iambic tetrameter. You know, there are 4 groupings of 2 syllabi, and so there are 8 syllabi here. And we can see that the first level is unstressed, second is stressed, and it is one set. The second set is made of third and fourth syllabi, in which third is unstressed, fourth is stressed, and so on. We find that it is iambic tetrameter meter that the poet has made for composition of this kind of thing. And we also find that it is the simile which has been very, very majestically used by the poet, because the beauty that he has observed of daffodils is to be compared with the just a sky twinkling in the Milky Way. He is just using the term that 10,000 daffodils almost he has seen. We can say it is also hyperbole, because the poet has not counted the number, you know, but he is making an impression, because it is endless line of daffodils that poet is watching, and he thinks that maybe it is near about 10,000, but the intention of the poet is to convey that it is numerous daffodils there, and they are all in the line dancing with the breeze. And similar situation we can find in the sky when numerous stars are twinkling in the Milky Way. So it is a very good example of simile and hyperbole that the poet has made. Hyperbole in the sense that he had made just the numbers that maybe it is 10,000. So it is hyperbolic, that it is exaggeration maybe, but the intention of the poet is, intent of the feeling is that he is going to give an impression that it was so many that he was very much gazing at the numbers of, you know, daffodils blooming and dancing there in the lake. So that hyperbolic expression is meant for giving the kind of impression on the reader that it was uncounted. The poet was not finding it possible to count. So sometime hyperbolic example is going to make an impression on the reader that he has just tried to make. And this kind of simile example that he had made between the dancing daffodils on the one hand and the just twinkling stars on the other hand is for just making the beauty that these two things are creating for the observer. You know, so we can say that it is here expression that 10,000 daffodils at a glance, you know, and never ending to make difference is just the thing that he is also trying to make the difference between perception and reality. You know, we are perceiving, you know, it is not exact perception, where actually you are under the influence of beauty. We can say that we lose the sense of actual perception, and we are then seeing the real thing from the average perception point of view, and so we are just making that kind of thing. So we can say that it was simply so many daffodils that the poet's eyes have never caught. And you know, so you can say the poet's eyes were blessed with this kind of thing. So, and his heart was overwhelmed also seeing all these kind of things fluttering, dancing, tossing their heads, you know. So, you know, these are all, you know, what he can call gerund form or just a participle form of the verb used by the poet, that it goes on doing that kind of thing. It is not for a moment that daffodils are fluttering, daffodils are just dancing, and daffodils are tossing. It is for many just hours. It is for many huge time that the daffodils are doing the same kind of thing. And when we are simply captured into such a beautiful thing, we can say that we are also very much fond of this kind of natural beauty and so on. So we can say that it is the romantic expression that he had made, and he was very much swayed in the current of the beauty that the poet has felt. You know, so we can say that the last stanza of the poem is much more important and significant, that it is making us feel the great impact of that natural beauty that it lives on our heart and mind. We can see that we are always under the influence of that kind of natural beauty. You know, in all situations, we are actually just going to make our life revive, you know. Maybe we are in jokun mode, or maybe we are in very sorry mood, and so on. We find that we can just use that kind of natural beauty that we have already captured in our mind to make us revive, you know. It is just for revival of, you know, it is a kind of resilience that we can find against the crisis that life is creating before us. You know, most often you find that you are in a very critical situation, that we do not find any way to come out. And most often you find that the natural world has shown the way to the problem. And, you know, so many scientists were fond of just observing natural phenomena so closely. And we know that so many scientific inventions are all due to the observation of the great scientists in the natural world, you know. So, you know, it is very much what we can call an open book for study of the nature. You know, if you are actually learning and trying to learn the behavior pattern of nature, we can find something new, or some kind of invention therein, and it will be of great help for us, you know, because it also provides us a very solemn atmosphere for our thought and so on. And we can thought in the garden is very much example of the poem, where we can sit and we can consider what the sublime is there. And the sublime thing that the just a philosopher and a laureates have just given to the world are all due to their just spending of time into that natural world that they have spent. And so poet is just finding nature for double purpose. It is first to relieve the poet from the natural tension of the life, from the natural crisis of the life. It is just the direct benefit for all the people, whosoever they are, you know. And we find that in some way or other, and in some time or other, we find ourselves into this situation. But for the person like philosopher, like scientist, like poets, it is a great course of invention also. Thank you.